We are honored to have a former IAF with us tonight, and not just your normal extraordinary IAF, but one who happens to be the Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice. Condi, as people probably don't know, spent a year as an IAF about 2 decades ago, almost exactly. Sorry to point this out. Oh, that was classified. I apologize. Darn. She served it in the five-sided building down in Washington, and there she was special assistant to the director of the Joint Chiefs. Is that correct? And she worked, among other things, on a project dealing with sort of going down to zero nukes, if I remember. An issue which, shall we say, is very much back in circulation today. And when Condi has talked about this program, she's described it as one of the best experiences of her life, which is nice to hear. She is, in a sense, the ultimate scholar practitioner. Let me say one or two personal things. She's a dear and long-standing friend. I was going to say old friend, but this could be easily misunderstood. I was supposed to get a joke. I got to laugh. As usual, it's hard to predict. We worked closely together during two administrations. First, the administration of the 41st president, when we were both young tykes on the National Security Council staff. And more recently, we worked in the administration of the current president. At that time, Condi Rice, before she was Secretary of State, was still the National Security Advisor, and I was at the State Department. So, Madam Secretary, it is great to have you back at an organization that knows you well and you know well.
I wanted to answer a couple of questions that I'm asked all the time. And those questions go something like this. Well, is there anything that has surprised you about this job? Or what would you think differently about what you were going to do if you were able to go back and start over again? Or do you have different ideas now about what is required for American foreign policy? Translation, if you had a chance to do this all over again, would you do it this way, or wouldn't you do something else? Haven't you made lots of mistakes, and wouldn't you correct them the next time? That's the translation of all of those questions. Well, I thought that I would take the track of doing the following, which is to say, yes, there have been surprises. There have been some things that have been constants that were fully expected. And I'd like to talk to you briefly about a few of those, the continuity and the change in American foreign policy over the last several years, because when one experiences an event like September 11th, as our country did, a seminal event of that kind, a kind of earthquake in foreign policy, it's not surprising that it has an enormous effect on your strategic outlook, on the way that you think about things. And I can tell you that if you were in a position of authority on September 11th, then every day since has been September 12th. And you have tried ever since then to think about strategies and means by which it won't happen again. But I never thought that I would spend as much time as I do thinking about the fate of failed states and trying to resurrect failed states, trying to resurrect states that were coming out of sustained conflict, and trying to use all of the tools of the nation, whether it is foreign assistance or military training or public diplomacy, the elements, to use those elements to try and help build well-governed democratic states where states were failing. And I famously said in an article in 2000 in Foreign Affairs that perhaps it wasn't a good idea for the 82nd Airborne to take school kids to be school crossing guards and take school kids to school. I still think that's right, but somebody's got to do it. And what we are learning is that the weakness of civilian institutions to do the business of state building is one of the true lacuna, one of the true holes in our national capacity. To be frank, we tried in the Balkan Wars to have the United Nations do that role, and it was not wholly successful. In Afghanistan, it was, frankly, adopt a ministry. Many different countries adopted different ministries as a part of the bond process. And while it was important in drawing in national capacity and international support, we are living with some of the incoherence of that effort today in Afghanistan. In Iraq, we tried giving it to one department, the Department of Defense, and it turns out they weren't really ready to do that either. And so now we've got a new idea, and the building of the Civilian Response Corps, which has within the United States government a specialist from different disciplines who can go and help with police training or help with justice systems or help with agriculture, is an important innovation. Finally, I'll say that we've learned the importance of being and advocating for, in an active way, democracy. And it's on this point that I'd like to end. A lot has been said about the democracy agenda, the freedom agenda. How goes it? How can we evaluate it at this point in time? You will remember that in the second inaugural, the president talked about ending tyranny. But he didn't talk about ending tyranny tomorrow. He talked about this as a generational requirement, something that generations would work toward. But what that speech did and was intended to do was to say that for the United States, there can be no contradiction between our national interest and our national values. That whether or not, and there sometimes are, there are short-term contradictions and tensions between strategic interests and our values. We can never see them as in tension in the long run. In other words, the United States cannot be neutral about what kinds of systems countries should have. And indeed, that has been the democracy agenda. It has come to the fore because, as we have seen, particularly in the Middle East, the absence of freedom, the absence of democracy, leads to a kind of freedom gap, and something will fill it. When there is an authoritarian regime that does not permit the development of healthy politics, politics will develop, but it will develop in radical mosques and in madrasas. And that is what we've seen in much of the Middle East. Now, the democracy agenda, I think I could argue, was at least a part of our foreign policy in almost every area of the world. But frankly, the Middle East was considered to be something of an exception. We talked about stability, not about democracy. And I know that there is sometimes a sense that perhaps we disturb the stability of the Middle East by introducing this theme of democracy. But I would submit to you that it wasn't a very stable place to begin with, and we could list the list of horrors of Saddam Hussein or of Syrian occupation of Lebanon or on and on. But most importantly, it was not stable because underneath there was this growing extremism, a response to the absence of legitimate politics, and it had to be dealt with.
You say that we knew better where we had been than where we were going. And I get a sense from both your comments today and from the 2008 article that we definitely have rethought our national interests and we have a better sense of where we are going. But where are we going? Are we in Fareed Zakaria's terms sort of entering the post-American era?
Yeah.
Have we gone in Richard's concept from a unipolar world to a nonpolar world?
Well, far be it from me to disagree with Richard or with Fareed.
I mean, we do it
good,
all the time.
They're both good friends. I don't think it's somebody else's century. The one thing that I am continually struck by in this job is the degree to which everybody believes that the United States has to take a leading role, often in things where we don't actually believe we ought to take a leading role. One of the hardest parts of my job is to say, you know, really, you could probably solve that without us. Or call me when you need my help to another foreign minister. And sometimes people really step up. What's interesting to me is when they do, we very often get, well, the United States was sidelined. Let me give you an example. The recent Doha agreement in Lebanon. Not only is it very much like the Taif agreement, which, by the way, was Saudi Arabia without U.S. help, but in 89, but it was through active U.S. diplomacy that the Arab League took the lead in solving the Lebanon crisis. We met in France with the Friends of Lebanon, France, Great Britain, and the responsible Arab states like Saudi Arabia and the UAE and Egypt and Jordan, and Amr Moussa of the Arab League. And they had an initiative, and we backed their initiative, and it worked. And so when you sometimes see that Lebanon has been, the crisis in Lebanon has been resolved by someone else, don't assume that it's because the United States was pushed to the sidelines. Assume that the United States thinks it's awful good idea if sometimes somebody else takes the lead.
What prospects do you see for the development of genuinely democratic institutions in China? And what role can the United States play in encouraging such developments?
China is clearly going through a major transition in terms of its economic life. Everybody sees that. I think the question is whether or not this kind of economic growth, activity, creativity, innovation that we're starting to see in China can continue to exist in a political system that is hierarchical and rigid. And I frankly don't think that it can. I am a firm believer that in the long run, maybe not in the short one, but in the long run, it's not going to be possible to recognize your people's talents and not recognize their rights. Eventually, with the growth of middle class and the growth of people with property rights and all of the things that are starting to happen in China, there will be a desire to be able to access and to be able to petition the government.